Let's gather for worship. Let's open our hearts to God's Spirit. Let's sing. And let's sing number 650, which should put us in a mood of rejoicing. Number 650. Together for your glory. And so we ask this morning that as we come together to worship you, that you would fill our hearts with those amazing and joyful and wonderful things that you have done for each of us just this week. We ask all this in your name. Amen. During the prelude this morning, please spend some time in prayer. And in meditation, take a look at the passages of Scripture that we'll be using in our service this morning. The first one is Psalm 90, and then the next one is John 6, verses 22 through 35. And as you read those, particularly the Gospel of John, keep in mind that this is a sequel from last week, and that may help you to meditate on the passage. But in all ways, invite God to speak to you. No matter what I say to you. Thank you, Bunny. Our call to worship this morning is Psalm 90, and we'll read it responsively. And if you're able, please rise as we read. Lord, you have been our dwelling place in all generations. turn us back to dust and say, turn back, you mortals.
For a thousand years in your sight, the light yesterday, when it is past, forever watched in the night.
You sweep them away. They are like a dream, like grass that is renewed in the morning.
In the morning, it grows and is renewed. In the evening, it fades and withers.
For we are consumed by your anger. By your wrath, we are overwhelmed.
You have set our iniquity before you, our secret sin, the light of your countenance.
For all our days pass away under your wrath. Our years come to an end like a sigh.
The days of our life are 70 years. Our past 80, if we are strong. Even then, there is only the sword and the trouble. It has soon gone, and we fly away.
Who considers the power of your anger? Your wrath is as great as the fear that is due you.
So keep us.
Turn, O Lord, how long? Have compassion on your servants.
Satisfy us in the morning with your steadfast love, so that we may rejoice in the new hour of our days.
Make us glad as many days as you have afflicted us, and as many years as we have seen evil. Let the favor of the Lord our God be upon us, and prosper us for the work of our hands. O prosper the work of our hands. Amen. Now, if you'll take your hymn books and turn to number 100. Number 100. Seated. The sermon this morning is based on John chapter 6,
Gospel of John, chapter 6, beginning at verse 22 and reading through verse 35. When they found him, let's back up a little bit. The next day, the crowd that had stayed on the other side of the sea saw that there had been only one boat there. They also saw that Jesus had not got into the boat with his disciples, but that his disciples had gone away alone. Then some boats from Tiberias came near the place where they had eaten the bread after the Lord had given thanks. So when the crowd saw that neither Jesus nor his disciples were there, they themselves got into the boats and went to Capernaum looking for Jesus. When they found him on the other side of the sea, they said to him, "Rabbi, when did you come here?" Jesus answered them, "Very truly I tell you, you are looking for me, not because you saw signs, but because you ate your fill of the loaves. Do not work for the food that perishes, but for the food that endures for eternal life, which the Son of Man will give you. For it is on him that God the Father has set his seal." Then they said to him, What must we do to perform the works of God?" Jesus answered them, "This is the work of God, that you believe in him whom he has sent." So they said to him, "What sign are you going to give us then, so that we may see it and believe you? What work are you performing?" "Our ancestors ate the manna in the wilderness, as it is written, 'He gave them bread from heaven to eat.'" Then Jesus said to them, "Very truly I tell you, it was not Moses who gave you the bread from heaven, but it is my Father who gives you the true bread from heaven. For the bread of God is that which comes down from heaven and gives life to the world." They said to him, "Sir, give us this bread always." Jesus said to them, "I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never be hungry, and whoever believes in me will never be thirsty." Let's pray. Lord, open our hearts this morning to hear and to believe your words. Keep me out of the way, if necessary. Amen. At the end of the sermon last week, I took us to the Gospel of John, chapter 14, and I read these words of Jesus. "Very truly I tell you, the one who believes in me will also do the works that I do, and in fact will do greater works than these, because I am going to the Father." The disciples, as we very clearly saw last Sunday, did not believe these words at all. And neither do we. We may, with some of our hearts, wish to believe these words of Jesus, but deep down in the rest of our hearts, the remaining portions, we are very much afraid of even trying to believe these words. We can easily predict with much fear and with much trembling the consequences of even attempting to believe these words. In our passage this morning, the picnic is over. And it is over literally and figuratively. It turns out that life is not going to be the picnic that everyone had hoped for. The leftovers have been all gathered up. John doesn't seem to bother to tell us what became of them, but they've been gathered up. And Jesus has returned to his home at Capernaum after a rather rough boat ride during the evening. If you weren't here last week, the picnic to which I am referring is the famous story of the feeding of the 5,000. On that day, Jesus made the desert bloom. With only 5 loaves and 2 tiny fishes, Jesus fed everyone there in the wilderness until they were satisfied fully. But now there is a huge problem. The adoring crowds present at the picnic have once again located Jesus, and in spite of strong encouragement to do it again, Jesus isn't about to deliver. In ancient Hebrew thinking, and in later first century Jewish thinking, there was a theological expectation, much like there is today, that the present age would wind down and begin to emerge into the age to come. And that as that happened, as the old age moved away and the new age began to move in, that a prophet, very similar to Moses, would come to this earth and usher in a brand new golden age for the people of God. God's people have always believed that the present age is winding down, and that the age to come is beginning to emerge. But 2,000 years ago, in the first century, those expectations were especially high. And depending on whom one follows these days, the age to come is somewhere just around the corner, or still millennia into the future. I suspect strongly that the age to come will come when it comes. And when it comes, it will be a great and wonderful surprise to all of us, just as Jesus said it would be. But in Jesus' day, almost everyone was looking around the next corner for this mysterious age to come. If there ever was a time for a new Moses to appear on the scene, it was in the first century. In fact, from a first century perspective, if Moses or a prophet like him was going to show up, he had better hurry up and get here. He'd better do it now. Like God's people of old in Egypt, the people of Palestine were yearning for deliverance, not from the Egyptians, but rather from the Romans. Send us a prophet, O God, they cried. Any prophet will do. Just get us out of here. We're done with this place. Sound the slightest bit familiar? And so along comes Jesus. And what can he do? He can produce bread in the wilderness. And it is very clear and very obvious that the participants in yesterday's picnic are pretty theologically sophisticated. They have already made the very strong connection between Moses and Jesus. And they have already noticed the similarities between Moses' ministry and Jesus' ministry. All we need to do is look back in verse 14 and we'll know that. As soon as the picnic was over and the fragments of food were being gathered up, the people were already saying to each other, "This is indeed the prophet who is to come into the world. This is the new Moses." And so, the next day, after the picnic, what is the very reasonable expectation from the new Moses? It is, of course, some more food. Do it again, Jesus. Prove to us that you are indeed the prophet who is to come into this world. If you really are the new Moses, ante up. Give us this day our daily bread. But of course, Jesus isn't about to do that. Jesus may very well be the new Moses, at least in the people's minds, but he is also very different from Moses. He is actually greater, far greater than Moses, but we are not going to be able to convince this crowd that has chased him down in Capernaum of that stunning reality anytime soon. They are convinced, so far at least, that Moses is still greater than Jesus. And Moses is still greater than Jesus because Moses provided the miracle of food every single day, except for the Sabbath. On the day before the Sabbath, folks could gather up enough manna to last them through the weekend, but none of it appeared on the Sabbath. And all of that was just wonderful. At least it was in retrospect. In retrospect, we know that the sun always shines. There is never a cloud in retrospect. It is always just beautiful. In retrospect, memory is always better than reality. In truth, in Moses' day, the people hated the stuff that arrived every single day except for the Sabbath. They despised it. They quickly grew bored with it, and they had to eat it for 40 days running. That may very well be part of the lesson that Jesus is attempting to teach in our passage this morning. This is one of my favorite illustrations. I use it all the time. Anyone who has ever had a kid, finish it. Oh, come on. Anyone who has ever had a kid standing in front of an open refrigerator door and declaring there's nothing to eat in this house is kindred spirit with the disciples who said, there's nothing here but. You all know exactly what I'm talking about. My favorite illustration. Daily bread can get dull. Very dull. And quite frankly, a daily diet of fish and bread wouldn't take that long to set me to complaining either. How many days in a row can a person eat tuna fish sandwiches? So, right off the bat, Jesus says to the adoring but greedy crowd, very truly I tell you, you are looking for me not because you saw signs, but because you ate your fill of the loaves. Do not work for the food that perishes, but for the food that endures for eternal life, which the Son of Man will give you. No preacher on this earth would dare to say something like that. Did you ever wonder why food rots? It rots because, as in the days of old, if it did not rot, we would gather too much of it. The same is also true of everything else in our lives. Anything that we can gather up, anything that we can amass, rots. Everything rots. Even classic cars that are meticulously maintained and restored will rot no matter how much money you throw at them. And if you don't believe that, Meg can tell you all about it. Everything on this planet returns to the earth out of which it was created. That's what our psalm said this morning. So Jesus is saying, don't be grasping. Don't be spending all of your energy trying to grab hold of the things that perish. Grab instead for the things that last for eternity. Things that perish or things that rot can only satisfy for a time. And then they become dull. Or worse, like the people of old, we come to despise the very things that we once lusted for, that we once believed that were so necessary to obtain. This may be a tough truth to embrace, but everything that we touch in this world is merely temporary. None of the stuff of this world that we labor so hard for will see us one moment beyond our last breath. But if we can embrace that truth, at least in our hearts, we will discover that Jesus offers us a form of nourishment that will not only see us to our graves, but beyond them and into all of eternity. This nourishment, this bread, Jesus says, is the bread of God which comes down from heaven and gives life to the world. In the hearts and in the minds of the adoring crowd, they are all probably still thinking about the manna that miraculously appeared every morning. These people are, after all, seeking a new Moses, a new deliverer, someone who can rescue them from their present oppression by the Romans. And so they say to Jesus, "Sir, give us this bread always." But a true deliverer, a true Savior, provides more, much more nourishment than mere manna, or even some special, fantastic, secret recipe, homemade new bread that supersedes manna in a million ways, but that still rots. And perhaps deep down in our hearts, it is only yeasty bread that we really want. And that's a shame. How do we sound sometimes? Just a little better life, Jesus. That's all I want. A little less worry. A little more ease. And then I'll be satisfied. Jesus has made it plain in this passage, however, that it isn't Jesus' intent for us to just have a little better life, just a few more things, a little less worry, a little more ease, and then we'll be okay. It wasn't his intent for the crowd that day, and it isn't his intent for us. He isn't going to give us what he wouldn't give them. What he will give us, though, is himself. It is his life, his words, his divine origin, his eternal existence that is our gift. All of these things, life, divine origin, eternal existence, are what he is holding out to us right now that have nowhere near the appeal that yeasty, rotted bread does. Unfortunately, the Lord Jesus satisfies our deepest and truest needs, those needs that are hidden in the remote places of our souls. This is the Lord Jesus Christ, who by satisfying the deepest longings of our souls, teaches us to put into perspective the daily struggles of life that so frequently vex us. Jesus said, "I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never be hungry, and whoever believes in me will never be thirsty." Do we believe that Jesus can satisfy us so completely? Do we believe what Jesus just said? Will we believe Jesus? Let's pray. Lord, help us to believe you. Amen. Our hymn of response this morning is number 93. If you're able, please rise as we sing. Thank you, Lord, for the love that we feel in this place week after week from one another and from you. Thank you that we can come to you and to the rest of us with our heart's deepest needs. Thank you for watching over us during the week. Help us. Count our blessings when we are tempted to count our banes. Be with Jeff and Maura as they travel to Connecticut this weekend. Give them a grand visit with Maura's mom. Be with Bob as he has some difficult decisions to make tomorrow. Fill him with your peace. Give him wisdom. Make it clear to him what your will is in his life.
We give you thanks along with Marie this morning that she's feeling better. We ask that you'd be with those who grieve, especially this morning with the family of Henry Carey. We give you thanks for healing, for touching our bodies, for being our Savior. And so we rejoice this morning with Carol as she's noticed the swelling has gone down in her eye, and Lord, please make that permanent. For Alton this morning, we give you thanks for his age, for his wisdom, for his love for you, for his love for us. We ask that you bless him, and bless him with a large print Bible. And Lord, for Judy's brother, we ask that you would first of all fill him with peace and hope. Help him not to become discouraged, even though the temptation is there. It is our heart's desire, Lord, that you would heal him and make him strong. And we ask all of these things in the name of Jesus, because he is the one who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Let's sing about our Redeemer, and that is number 117. Thank you, Lord, for sending us our Redeemer. Help us this week to believe what he has said to us just a little bit more. Amen.